And so, you know, you still see the kind of current iterations of states, you know, funding white colleges where they won't fund black colleges.
I am so excited for this conversation today. It is an extremely important conversation that we are having with Adam Harris. He is the author of The State Must Provide, Why America's Colleges Have Always Been Unequal and How to Set Them Right. Welcome, Adam. Good to see you.
Thanks so much for having me. Good to see you.
Listen, you hit the nail on the head. America's colleges have always been unequal. Education in America has always been unequal, but I do feel like colleges don't always get the same share of attention as maybe, you know, secondary schooling or K through 12, where, you know, we know about Brown versus Board. Explain it to me systemically. How have America's colleges been unequal all this time for Black folks?
Going back to the roots and the foundation of the higher education system as we recognize it and understand it today, it was never built on a broad foundation of equality or equity, right? It was when the federal government made its largest investment ever in higher education in 1862 with the passage of a bill that basically gave states land to sell in order to fund a university. Those institutions, the institutions that were created out of that, Penn State, Iowa State, Michigan State, Cornell is a land grant institution, Auburn, those institutions did not enroll Black students, right? So from that beginning, when the federal government was first saying we need to invest in higher education, Black students were fundamentally shut out of those institutions. You fast forward 30 more years, they went to the government for more money and the government said, well, you at least have to have a separate college for Black students. And so effectively the 1890 Morrill Act helped provide funding for some HBCUs. Some states use it to create HBCUs, others use it to fund it. But on top of that, I think the thing that gets missed is that, you know, the institutions which received funding initially also received an injection of funding when the HBCUs received their funding. So you start to see the wealth stratification develop, and it only gets worse.
So you're telling me they were like, we would rather build new schools than to have Black people at our school and give y'all money. So you don't have to have Black people at your schools. That is insane. What other things were done to keep Black students out of universities? What extremes did folks go to?
So leading up to Brown v. Board of Education, there was a string of litigation by the NAACP that effectively tried to break down little by little the lie of separate but equal. So the first case was the Gaines case, where Lloyd Gaines was trying to attend law school in Missouri. And they were like, well, you at least need to have a separate option for Black students. And they didn't have a separate law school for Black students. So you can't have separate but equal if you don't have a separate. Ada Louise Sipple Fisher's case in Oklahoma in the 1940s was a lot the same way. And when the Supreme Court said again, hey, Oklahoma, you need to have a separate option for Black students, the state rushed a law school into existence in 5 days. They rented out a room on the in the state house. They hired 3 faculty members, paid them part-time for what would be full-time work. Once Black students did integrate the University of Oklahoma, they literally put a bar in the class to separate Black and white students in the classroom. So it's really interesting the way that the states fought to hold on to their sort of to hold on to segregation in schools, even once Black students made their way into formerly all white classrooms.
So that makes me think, if they're able to pull together a law school in just a few days for a Black student to keep him out of the, you know, the general law school that they had, that means that they have money, right? There is a way for them to create educational opportunities. We shouldn't be in a space of separate and unequal, but it seems to me that as amazing as so many of our HBCUs are, sometimes students are not getting that equal experience in terms of resources or endowments or investment. Where is the inequality today at our HBCUs?
Yeah, and I think that is, you made a really good point. It's not about the, you know, the education that they're getting at the school. It's about the resources. It's about the, you know, the deferred maintenance in the building. So you'll have older buildings on Black college campuses. Typically, you know, the endowments are smaller. So my own institution, Alabama A&M University, is right near University of Alabama Huntsville, which was founded 75 years after Alabama A&M was founded, because segregation was the law in Alabama, and because you know, they wanted to create an institution for white students in the area. And now today, UAH has a larger endowment than Alabama A&M, which has been around for, you know, a century and a half at this point. And so, you know, the inequality rears its head in several ways. So you have, we're in an institution like North Carolina A&T, right? The third largest research producing institution in the state of North Carolina. When they made the jump to become a high activity research producing institution in the early 2000s, you know, they weren't given any additional money by the state to make that move. When two predominantly white institutions made that same move, you know, less than a couple of years later, they were given $10 million apiece. And so, you know, you still see the kind of current iterations of states, you know, funding white colleges where they won't fund Black colleges. And then on top of all of it, right, so several of the Black colleges are land grant institutions. And in some states, you'll have the predominantly white land grant receiving, you know, up to triple, four times the funding match, whereas the HBCU isn't even getting half. So you still see all of these ways where the discrimination is very pervasive and very clear, even today.
Well, we're talking about money, and I think HBCUs are having a moment in the sun, as they deserve, right? If you watch Beyonce Homecoming, she's shouting out HBCUs. We're seeing all of these incredible donations being made on behalf of philanthropists, but I still have questions, because what happens when the philanthropists move on to the next thing, or they don't feel as generous? How do we set up our HBCUs for success long-term?
Yeah, and it's actually interesting, because we have seen in the past the way that philanthropy sort of ebbs and flows. Like, you know, it's often forgotten that a lot of HBCUs were started by wealthy Northern white philanthropists. And, you know, as their interests in Black education sort of waned, so did that funding to some of those HBCUs. And so, you know, you have to think of this kind of current moment, right, where by any stretch of the imagination, 2020 was a landmark year for giving to Black colleges. You know, a lot of institutions received their largest ever single donation. But, you know, some of those single donations were $5 million. And that was the largest ever donation that an institution received. My own institution, so Alabama A&M, got just recently, within the last week or two, a $2.2 million donation. That's the largest it's ever received in its history, the largest single donation in its history. It's been around for 150 years almost. And so, you know, thinking about the way that philanthropy can help, but that it's not sort of a solve for overall kind of this history and legacy of systemic discrimination, I think for particularly for state institutions, you have to look at the way that states and the federal government are funding higher education. Are they funding it with equity in mind? So if you are trying to account for, you know, low-income students, for example, HBCUs, 61% of students who attend HBCUs are eligible for federal grants for low-income students. So they're Pell eligible, right? So if states were to kind of change their funding algorithms in order to, you know, help institutions that are serving populations that are typically underserved by higher education, whether that's Black students, Brown students, low-income students, HBCUs would actually be receiving more funding in that calculation.
I like that. The idea of responsibility, maybe it fits into our conversation about reparations, you know, and the ways in which reparations can actually be implemented. Adam, I want to ask you about student loan debt, because it's so much a part of this conversation of wealth building and inequality and the ways in which young Black folks are held back from building wealth because they're saddled with debt. Is this a social justice issue at this point?
You know, I really think it is. And in the conversation about, you know, the racial wealth gap, I think that this student loan crisis cannot be, you know, separated from that conversation, because Black students, you know, are more likely to take on student debt. They're more likely to take on more student debt. They're more likely to default on that student debt. I think that you know, if we have the sort of broader debt cancellation conversation and that becomes a reality, then I don't think that can happen without a debt-free or a tuition-free college conversation as well, because it would just be sending people back into debt after you know, clear a massive amount of debt. So I think the two have to happen in concert. I think including HBCUs in that formulation is incredibly important.